us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins unto God our Father, beseeching him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord. My transgressions unto the Lord.
And thou forgivest the iniquity of my sin.
Almighty God, our Maker and Redeemer, we poor sinners confess unto thee that we are by nature sinful and unclean, and that we have sinned against thee by thought, word, and deed. Wherefore we flee for refuge to thine infinite mercy, seeking and imploring thy grace for the sake of our Lord Jesus Christ. O most merciful God, who hast given thine only begotten Son to die for us, have mercy upon us, and for his sake grant us remission of all our sins. And by thy Holy Spirit, increase in us true knowledge of thee and of thy will, and true obedience to thy word, to the end that by thy grace we may come to everlasting life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, our heavenly Father, hath had mercy upon us, and hath given his only Son to die for us, and for his sake forgiveth us all our sins. To them that believe on his name, he giveth power to become the sons of God, and hath promised them his Holy Spirit. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. Grant this, Lord, unto us all. Testimonies are very sure. Holiness becometh thine house, O Lord, forever. Thy throne is established of old. Thou art from everlasting. The Lord reigneth. He is clothed with majesty. The Lord is clothed with strength, wherewith he hath girded himself.
Amen.
beloved Son, we may be made to abound in good works through the same Jesus Christ, thy Son, our Lord, who liveth and reigneth with thee and the Holy Ghost, ever one God, world without end. And of the fear of the Lord, and shall make him of quick understanding in the fear of the Lord. And he shall not judge after the sight of his eyes, neither reprove after the hearing of his ears, but with righteousness shall he judge the poor, and reprove with equity for the meek of the earth. And he shall smite the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips shall he slay the wicked. And righteousness shall be the girdle of his loins, and faithfulness the girdle of his reins. Here ended the lesson. The epistle is written in the book of Galatians, the 4th chapter. St. Paul writes, "Now I say that the heir, as long as he is a child, differeth nothing from a servant, though he be Lord of all, but is under tutors and governors until the time appointed of the father. Even so we, when we were children, were in bondage under the elements of the world. But when the fullness of time was come, God sent forth his Son, made of a woman, made under the law, to redeem them that were under the law, that we might receive the adoption of sons. And because ye are sons, God hath sent forth the Spirit of his Son into your hearts, crying, Abba, Father. Wherefore, thou art no more a servant, but a son, and if a son, then an heir of God through Christ." Here ended the epistle. Thou art fairer than the children of men. Grace is poured into thy lips. My heart is inditing a good matter. I speak of the things which I have made touching the king. My tongue is the pen of a ready writer. Hallelujah, hallelujah. The Lord reigneth. He is clothed with majesty. The Lord is clothed with strength, wherewith he hath girded himself. Hallelujah. Chapter beginning at the 22nd verse. And when the days of her purification according to the law of Moses were accomplished, they brought him to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord, as it is written in the law of the Lord, every male that openeth the womb shall be called holy to the Lord, and to offer a sacrifice according to that which is said in the law of the Lord, a pair of turtle doves, or two young pigeons. And behold, there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon. And the same man was just and devout, waiting for the consolation of Israel. And the Holy Ghost was upon him. And it was revealed unto him by the Holy Ghost that he should not see death before he had seen the Lord's Christ. And he came by the Spirit into the temple, and when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him after the custom of the law, then took he him up in his arms and blessed God and said, Lord, now lettest thou thy servant depart in peace according to thy word. For mine eyes have seen thy salvation, which thou hast prepared before the face of all people, a light to lighten the Gentiles and the glory of thy people Israel. And Joseph and his mother marveled at those things which were spoken of him. And Simeon blessed them and said unto Mary his mother, Behold, this child is set for the fall and rising again of many in Israel, and for a sign which shall be spoken against. Yea, a sword shall pierce through thy own soul also, that the thoughts of many hearts may be revealed. And there was one Anna, a prophetess, the daughter of Phanuel, of the tribe of Asher. She was of a great age and had lived with an husband 7 years from her virginity. And she was a widow of about 84 years, which departed not from the temple, but served God with fastings and prayers night and day. And she, coming in that instant, gave thanks likewise unto the Lord, and spake of him to all them that looked for redemption in Jerusalem. And when they had performed all things according to the law of the Lord, they returned into Galilee to their own city Nazareth. And the child grew and waxed strong in spirit, filled with wisdom, and the grace of God was upon him. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Shepherds as they watch by night appear.
peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. The first thing that we are presented with in the gospel lesson for the day is the required sacrifices and offerings that were necessary for Mary and Joseph to make. First of all, for Mary's purification after childbirth, and then also Jesus, being the firstborn son, had to be presented before the Lord. And so they went up to Jerusalem, and they did for him everything that was commanded in the law of the Lord. Now, what does this say to us? It tells us that right from the beginning of our Lord's life, he was already doing the work of his active obedience. That is, he was already, even in his infancy, obeying perfectly the law of the Lord on behalf of sinners who have broken that law and are therefore guilty before God. And so here, we take heart, we who know our sins, we who know our needs, we take heart in this newborn babe of Bethlehem, this Jesus who will save his people from their sins, because right from the very beginning, he is involved in our redemption. And so, you know, one of the things that gets lost with Christmas, you know, because Christmas emphasizes all the happy parts of God's word and our salvation. But always remember that the joy of Christmas is directly linked to the fact that there would be no salvation or redemption at all if it were not for this wonderful event that happened. God kept his word, brought his son into the world, and has accomplished to the fullest degree our eternal redemption. And therefore, we rejoice because we're not going to hell. And that is a big thing that gets lost in today's world. That the name of Jesus makes all of the difference between salvation and eternal damnation. And here we are seeing the Lord, even in his infancy, at work for the redemption and salvation of sinners, and that includes you and me. It also includes a person by the name of Simeon. And so we learn about Simeon here today. It says, there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon. And it tells us something about Simeon. The same man was just and devout. That is, he was a righteous man and he was an observer of his religion. We live in a world today when many people profess to be Christians, but they are not devout. They do not practice the faith that they profess. They are casual at best about the Lord Jesus and his salvation. Simeon, however, he was righteous and devout, and he was one of the many people in the land of Israel who was waiting for the consolation of Israel. So he was expecting and praying for and yearning for the coming of God's Messiah and the bringing of the consolation to the hearts of all those who for years had been bowed under oppression, bowed under all the crosses and difficulties of life, waiting long generations. When will God's promise be fulfilled? Many had given up expecting it to ever happen, but not Simeon and not all of God's faithful. And so it says here that he was one of many who were waiting for the coming of the Messiah. And the last thing it tells us about him in this verse is the Holy Ghost was upon him. That's what made him just and devout. Without the Holy Spirit, we are left with nothing but our own devices. And our own devices always lead us astray in spiritual things. And so when it tells us that the Holy Ghost was upon him, it tells us what is the source of our righteousness and our devoutness. It is the new life that we receive in Christ, given to us by the Spirit of God, by means of the Word and the sacrament. So the Holy Ghost was upon him. Now, that would be enough to consider. But it tells us one more thing in this text. It says, it was revealed unto him by the Holy Ghost that he should not see death before he had seen the Lord's Christ. So God had come to him and said to him, you will not die, old man. You will not die before you see the Messiah. And so every day Simeon came into the temple with an expectant heart, with a faith-filled heart, to serve the Lord and to proclaim the wonders of God's grace and the wonders of his word. And so it says here, he came by the Spirit into the temple. All right, so on the day that Mary and Joseph, they're not expecting anything except to do what they're required to do, they come into the temple, and at that moment, Simeon comes into the temple. He takes one look at that baby and he walks right over, takes him up in his arms and praises God. Now, Jesus looked, we got to remember this, keep this in your mind. He looked like every other baby being brought into the temple. All right. Jesus did not have a halo around his head like in the classic ark, right? He looked like every other baby, but he knew that it was the Messiah by means of the Holy Spirit, right? How is it that when the word of God is preached, you hear it and you nod your head in confession of it? How is it that that happens? How is it that you recognize the preaching of the Christian faith as the very word of God? Because the Holy Spirit has been given to you, and by means of the Spirit, you hear. You are one of the sheep who hear the voice of the Good Shepherd. You know the word of God when you hear it, and you rejoice in it. And so here we see Simeon, guided by the Spirit, filled with the Spirit, living in the expectation that is born of the Spirit in him. And when he sees Jesus, he recognizes him as God's answer to the need of the whole world. And so he takes him up in his arms, and he praised God, and he said, Lord, Now you're letting me die in peace, as your word has promised, because my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared before the face of all people. He is a light to enlighten the Gentiles, and he is the glory of thy people, Israel. By the way, this is why we use the Nunc Dimittis. This little praise of God is called the Nunc Dimittis, which means now lettest thou, right? The Nunc Dimittis is the post-communion hymn in our liturgy. Why is that? Because just like Jesus was concealed in his humanity, being brought by ordinary parents, looking like an ordinary baby in every way, yet recognized as the very gift of God by Simeon according to the Holy Spirit, so it is that when we come to the Lord's altar and we receive the body and blood of the Lord in the Holy Supper, we, by the word of God, recognize that we are not only eating bread and wine, but we are also eating the true body and blood of the Lord. But we are doing it in a condition of lowliness and humility. To the world, it looks like a little piece of bread and a little sip of wine. But to those whose eyes are enlightened by the grace of God through faith, it is the very body and blood of Christ, just as the Lord Jesus has taught us. And so here, there's no more perfect response to having received the body and blood of Christ than to sing the song of Simeon and say, my eyes have seen thy salvation. Now I can die in peace. And that is a wonderful way to leave the table of the Lord and to go back into your daily callings. All right. So Mary and Joseph are astonished at this. And Simeon, he blessed them, gave them back the baby. And then he takes Mary aside. And he says to Mary, he says, listen, this child is set for the fall and rising of many in Israel, and for a sign that shall be spoken against. Now, why is it that he says this to Mary? Because Mary has already borne the cross in the name of the Lord Jesus. It is Mary who had to put up with all of the snide looks and the secret accusations. Remember, she was a young teenage girl who suddenly was pregnant. She went to visit her cousin Elizabeth, and when she came home, she had a baby bump. And you know how tongues will wag. And so Mary had to put up with no shortage of askance looks and troublesome gossip, and even the incredulity initially of Joseph, her betrothed husband, who was thinking that he might put her away quietly, all right? Until the angel of the Lord came and told him, no, no, Joseph, don't be afraid to take Mary your wife, because that which is conceived in her womb is of the Holy Ghost, and he shall be great, and he shall save his people from their sins. So here, Mary has already tasted the bitterness of the cross. She has had to take up her cross and follow Christ. And so it is that Simeon says to her, this child, he is set for the fall and rising of many in Israel. That is, some will be some will perish in their sins because of him, and others will be eternally saved because of him. He will be a dividing point among the people. Some will believe him and be saved. Others will reject him and be lost forever. And so he tells this to Mary. And then he also says to her, yea, and a sword shall pierce through thine own soul also. In other words, he hints here at the suffering that Mary will undergo as she stands at the foot of the true cross and watches her son give his life for the sins of the world. And he says, a sword shall pierce through your own soul as well, that the thoughts of many hearts may be revealed. Remember, every time you speak of Christ to somebody, you reveal their heart. Either they hear it and rejoice in it and accept it, or they harden their hearts against it, refuse it, and fail to be blessed in it. And so it is, the thoughts of many hearts are revealed in Jesus Christ. And then we hear this brief description of this woman named Anna. She was old, 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 and she was a widow of many, many years. And she was another one like Simeon, who was very devout. She spent all of her days in the temple, and she would speak to people about the coming of the Messiah. And she was very well known to the citizens of Jerusalem as one of those people who was always praising God, always in attendance at the services, always encouraging people to trust in the Lord. He will keep his word. He will not fail us. He will not forsake us. He will not let his word fall to the ground. And she came in also and gave thanks for the Lord Jesus, for his birth, for God's answer to the prayers. And she spoke of him to all those in the city of Jerusalem who were looking for redemption. So here we see Jesus, already our Redeemer, already active on our behalf for the eternal redemption that he has fully purchased and won for us. And we see, amidst all of the people who were busy about their ordinary lives without a care in the world about messiahs of any kind whatsoever, and yet there are always God's people here and there. Simeon, Anna, Mary, Joseph, the shepherds. And so there is always a faithful remnant of God's people in the world. And we thank God that by his grace, we are part of that faithful remnant even in our day. Amen. The peace of God that passeth all understanding, keep your hearts and your minds through Christ Jesus.
Thank you.
fulfilled thine ancient promises and given us in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. O Lord Jesus Christ, praise, glory, and honor be to thee. For out of thine unspeakable love, thou didst humble thyself that we might be exalted. Thou wast made man that we might be made heirs of God and fellow heirs with thee. Thou didst take upon thee the form of a servant that we might be renewed into the image of God. We sat in darkness and the shadow of death, but thou hast brought us life and peace and joy. O Holy Spirit, we praise and bless thee for making known to us and to all people by the preaching of the gospel the joyful tidings of the Holy Nativity. And we beseech thee, quicken us by thy grace and power, that we may not hear the Christmas message with passing wonderment only, but like Mary, ponder it in our hearts, that it may kindle in us the light of true faith and the fire of fervent devotion. Let us not be turned aside by doubts or fears, but like the shepherds, trusting fully in thy word, come with haste to see the things which have come to pass, accept them for our salvation, make known abroad, as we have opportunity, the great joy which shall be to all people. And glorify and praise God for the marvels of his grace and love. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Blessed Lord, who has caused all holy scriptures to be written for our learning, grant that we may in such wise hear them, read, mark, learn, and inwardly digest them, that by patience and comfort of thy holy word, we may embrace and ever hold fast the blessed hope of everlasting life, which thou hast given us in our Savior Jesus Christ, who liveth and reigneth with thee and the Holy Ghost, ever one God, world without end.
Amen.
The Lord bless thee and keep thee. The Lord make his face shine upon thee and be gracious unto thee. The Lord lift up his countenance upon thee and give thee peace.
Amen.